Hello, it's Keith here, and this is episode 7 of the Grime 6502 project. Now, after some work, I've kind of managed to get all the versions on the screen here, but obviously they don't quite fit. Anyway, the game is now finished and working on all of the systems. So let's go through them and try and have a look. It's going to be a bit interesting because some of them will all respond simultaneously when I use the joypad. So let's see what happens. Oh. So you can see dying a lot on some of these systems here, but the game is now working on all the systems and hopefully there's no problems with it. Now, I have had a go with the VIC-20 version. I said I was going to try using multicolor mode. I actually didn't properly understand multicolor mode yesterday when I said that. I assumed it applied to all of the screen, but apparently you can set it at the tile level. So while most of the tiles on the screen are not multicolor, I have used multicolor mode for the Descenders and the Invaders, so they are now two color, and also for the Game Over Grime, which is also two color, well, three color if you count black. Now, multicolor mode is actually four color, but the problem is one of the colors is always the background, one of the colors is always the border, and then one of the colors is the defined color for that tile, and one of the colors is the color for everything else on the screen, the alt color. So what I've done is I've defined the alt color as green for the title screen and the game over screen, and pink for the in-game play. The border is of course black and the screen is black, which is why I've only got two extra colours in addition to the background colour for the Ascenders, Descenders and the Game Over Grime. I thought that was the maximum I could use it without degrading the quality of the screen, because I thought the two colour tiles for the player and the general enemies, you can see that green, that two colour green grime descending now, so that's the only time that it really felt appropriate to use it without making the game actually end up looking worse. So anyway, there is some multicolour in there, but it's limited. But quite impressed by the mode. It's a nice idea. It's kind of a shame that the C64 doesn't offer something like that, or more systems don't do that kind of, you know, per tile level of color depth, because it does offer quite interesting combinations available. Anyway, so that's been done on the VIC-20 there. You could see some of the other versions playing away in the background. Let's try the C64 version. I've been doing more optimization work on the code. It's all been commented. As with last time, I'm going to do a final episode after the series, which is going to go over all of the source code in its final state. So I'm not going to really discuss the source code today, but you can see that the game's fully playable. As I say, that it's all now code commented. So when we do that final episode, you know, you'll have something that's relatively clear to look at, and the result will be what's available for download after the series. So anyway, you can see that's playing just fine here. C64 version is still, I think, a little bit slower. Here's the Apple II version. It's not had any real change since yesterday. I have changed the random number generation, though honestly I'm not sure if there is the final version's any better. It might actually be worse, to be honest, but never mind. I'm now using a set of 8 predefined random numbers, and I'm sort of bit shifting them in, and I'm still bit e-oring it, or x-oring it if you prefer, with some of the data of the code itself to try and get as much randomness in as possible. I think maybe it's a little bit better because I have now taken out the there were some safety nets in the code in case the random numbers never produce certain values. I think it now always produces every possible value from 0 to 255, but I have noticed that this column never seems to fill as fast as the others in the game over screen, which is a strong sign the random number generation isn't really good enough still, but it's at least good enough for now. So you know, I'll keep thinking about the random number problem on the 6502 systems. Let's get the PC Engine in here. I'm sorry, I've not really got enough screen. Oh, that was unexpected. This one's started up over here. So you can see here the game does work on the Atari 800 and 5200. The memory limitation, the 8K ROM limitation, didn't affect me with this game, which, as I say, I was confident that I could get the game small enough to fit within that limitation. I just wasn't I wasn't sure if I'd have time, because I've got debugging tools still installed, like the monitor code, which I use for monitoring the current state of registers and the memory, which is my main debugging tool. So you see that works just fine. And so let's try this version as well. Thank you. Well, I mean, you know, it's the same game on all the systems. That's the whole point of it. The logic code, as you should know if you've watched this series, is the same on all of the systems. It's only the graphical code that varies. So, you know, as long as there's no bugs in that graphical code, the game should be identical on all the systems. So yeah, Super Nintendo version now, nice and fast. Of course, I'm slowing the system down heavily. This is nowhere near the potential of the Super Nintendo, although I'm sure you all know that. And of course, I'm running the chip in 8-bit mode, so it's not the full capabilities of the system. I don't use any 65816 commands in my code. You can actually get the Super Nintendo running fine to this capacity without a single command. So, you know, that's something to note. And unfortunately, VASM doesn't actually support the 65816 because there's a lot of strange commands in it, and you need to do all kinds of things with the direct page because the zero page doesn't work the same. And so there's a lot of odd things you have to do with regards to your assembler to compile 65816. So it's not some. I did read a book on it. There was a power cut for a full week in Japan earlier in the year, and I was reading the instruction manual on a tablet. And even in such desperately bored times as that, I really struggled to actually sort of focus on it and build any enthusiasm for it, because it's such a. There's so many pages and pages of documentation of how to work around all of the limitations and how to maintain compatibility with 8-bit mode, because you have to, even if you're only planning to use 16-bit mode, because sometimes the CPU will switch to 8-bit mode automatically and things. And it didn't really look fun to code. And this was after I'd started learning 68000, and you just thought, oh my God, you know, 68000's so much easier than this. You know, it's not. You're not selling this to me as a solution for 16-bit processing. The 68000 is apparently much faster as well. It's about 30% faster from what I hear. But as I say, even if it wasn't, it's far easier to program. 68000 is generally easier than Z80, and Z80 is generally easier than 6502 in my experience. But as I say, 65816 is harder than everything else because it's just so complicated. There's so many things you have to do to use the 16-bit functionality, and then you still have to do a bunch of things to maintain 8-bit functionality. You know, I was seeing interrupt handlers that were like 40 lines just to keep things working without any actual functional code for the interrupt handler, and that was just to, you know, switch in the 8-bit modes and things. So as I say, I'm not too enthusiastic about 65816 at this time. Maybe one day. But anyway, irrelevant to this, you can see the NES version's working just fine now. So here's the Lynx version. Ooh. Keep dying immediately on the Lynx version. Don't think it's a bug in the code. I think it's a bug in my programming, if anything. Maybe the random number generation is tending to throw an invader directly at you. I'm not sure. Anyway, suffice to say, are they always appearing in the same place? They are always appearing in the... Okay, so I'll have to look at the random number generation on the links there. Anyway, basically, you can see it's mostly working. I'll try and fix the random number generation and figure out what's going on there. Yeah, every single one is appearing in exactly the same place. Okay, well, anyway, apart from... Oh, there's one that's in a different place. It's mostly working anyway. So the BBC version's quite good. The only limitation with the BBC is, unfortunately, that 32K of memory. If it had 64K of memory, I think it'd be a really nice system, but... By default, it doesn't, so that's what we have. Another interesting thing about the BBC is the BASIC interpreter has a assembler built in, so you can actually put assembly code straight into the BASIC, which is, you know, I think that's the BBC's influence, maybe, but the corporation, I mean. So, you know, that's something that the Amstrad CPC definitely couldn't do. So, you know, if I'd learned programming on a BBC, maybe I'd have learned assembly faster, because I never touched it until... You know, until about 12, 13 or something, very late in the BBC's evolution, very late in the Amstrad's evolution, and that was because there was a free assembler on the cover tape of the Amstrad Action. So there's all the versions anyway. So apart from that one bug in the Atari Lynx version, which I will fix after I finish this video, I think everything's okay. So I've been going over the source code, just generally commenting everything, as you can see. A lot of the comments are the same as they were originally, because most of the code is copied over from the Z80, but there's some bits that have changed in functionality. There's some new variables as well, like the I've created a second random seed just to make things a bit more random. The simple tile code I've been over, I've made a few slight tweaks optimization wise, and also I've code commented it, because this is of course specific to the 6502. Now with the other modules, the print character routines and things, I'm going to go over those in the tutorials. I haven't code commented them at this stage. That was just simply a time limitation, because having to get things working, and in some cases like the nest routine, I rewrote it several times, and maybe I'll rewrite it again one day, so I didn't want to spend time code commenting it at this stage. Anyway though, the game is working, it plays pretty nicely on all the systems. I've achieved everything really well. So what's coming next? Well, this was Grime 6502. Next is going to be Grime 68000. For the Patreon backers, that's going to come in just a few days after I've had a break for Christmas. But for the YouTube followers, you're going to see that next week. I'll be recreating the exact same game on five systems, 68000 systems. They are, of course, very, very different. They're much faster systems. They're much more powerful. But unfortunately, sometimes with the 68000 systems, you have to actually do more work to get data to the screen and things, so who knows what limitations are going to crop up on me. And the main problem I'm probably going to have is I've been programming 6502 for so long, I can't remember any of the 68000 commands, so I'll probably be making all kinds of horrendous mistakes because of being so used to 6502. But that's the nature of the beast. So anyway, hopefully you'll follow me for that, and we'll see what it's like converting a Z80 game into 68000, because I will be starting from the Z80 code, not the 6502 code, when I look to create that 68000 version. Anyway, I hope you've enjoyed today's episode, and I hope you've enjoyed Grime 6502. Thanks for watching, and goodbye.